Hey guys, it's Daniel Dr. D, and here they are. I couldn't resist. There was a lot of reviews about the Magnepan LRS Plus, and I just acquired these. They came in much faster than I had expected. I only ended up waiting like 2 weeks for them, and I thought it was going to be a few months, and lo and behold, I got a call from the distributor. And so let's begin. I'm going to cut this bad boy open. The little straps removed and see what this bad boy is packed like. It's packed quite nicely. All right, I just opened the blinds. Let's have a look at these bad boys. Interesting. Yeah, you can't find a used pair anywhere online. So I acquired these with my own money. And at the instruction manual with the Magnaplaner tags that you can stick on. These look like the monoliths from 2001, A Space Odyssey. Very cool. So you'll notice they picked this bubble wrap between the ribbons. Between the two speakers, so, and I think this is so that the ribbons don't move or something in shipment, because before they use magnets, which are a real pain in the neck, because it causes the cloth, the fabric, to stick to the ribbons themselves or whatever it is, those little aluminum things or whatever, the magnets. And you can look at some of my previous videos. I have some video of me trying to peel that off the planer. All right. Hey guys, this is Daniel Dr. D, and I'm back with another review, this time on the Magnepan LRS Plus. And those of you familiar with this will know that there's been tons of reviews on YouTube about these speakers, and everybody rants and raves about how good they are. And I can assure you that's justified, as I'm about to share with you. But I want to go over some things, a little bit of history here. I used to have a pair of Magnepan 0.7s. I ended up... My nephew ended up acquiring those speakers from me. I ended up letting those go. And part of the reason was because I was just enjoying the sensitivity and the amp flexibility, particularly tube amps, which I generally prefer, the ability to use those. And in most cases, you wouldn't use tube amps with these. Although there are a few scenarios where people have used them, but generally, a solid-state amplifier is recommended in a lot of current to run these things. And so anyway, I had those 0.7s, but I ended up selling them because, you know, they were not efficient. They didn't really image so well, and I was kind of used to the heritage speakers where you would hear kind of like, you know, individual instruments and point sources in the speaker itself. And but as time went on, I found myself missing these things, you know, listening to certain genres of music and recordings like Melody Gardot or Eva Cassidy, or if you want to listen to voices like Diana Krall. There's something so lifelike about the sound of voices that come from that emanate from these speakers, and it's really, truly, truly extraordinary. Now, one of the things I want to emphasize is the preamps. I'm using the Earhard. You know, I use the Earhard in here for the preamp stage in conjunction with the Vidar. Now, if you looked at my previous video on the Vidar, you'll see that I really like that Vidar amplifier. And if you're going on a budget system, you know, speaking of budget systems, Steve Guttenberg, I think he went sort of viral. He mentioned, I think at one of the trade shows in one of his interviews there, about how he would have been content with a Decware Zen integrated amplifier with a pair of Klipsch RP600Ms and a blue sound node. So the blue sound node would be your preamp stage, your DAC, and streaming all in one and with volume control. So you could do that. And if I were to pick an end game system, it would be these, with the shit Vidar 2 and the Blue Sound node, because you could use a Blue Sound for your preamp stage. And I just think it would be fabulous for a really good budget system. I mean, the value is incredible. So, and you know, nowadays it just seems like you don't have to spend big bucks to get incredibly good sound, you know? So, I think that's worth mention. Now, the reason I came around with these, and I was like, oh man, I had to get those voices back, you know? So I ended up getting these things, and man, I am just blown away at how good these things are. I don't feel that the comments online are exaggerated. Now, this is not a headbanger kind of speaker. It's not going to be like this slam bass or anything like that. But if you want to play like orchestral instruments, you know, guitar and violin concertos and harps and voices, and God, there are just to die for. The sound stage these things put up is just like second to none. And I'm so connected with this speaker compared to the 0.7. I didn't feel this chemistry with the 0.7, you know, over time. But with this, there's a chemistry with it. It's small, it's so easy to move. I can take it from different rooms to different other rooms. I don't know what they weigh. They're 48 inches tall, they're 13 inches wide and 1 inch deep. I mean, look at how thin these things are. And the idea, when you listen to these things, it's like music is floating in space in front of you. They're like, you know, a pair of monoliths from 2001, you know? But it just, the music just floats in front of you. And it's like there's no speaker there. And I'm like, God, this actually does sound good. You know, even though they don't image like a pinpoint source and all the music and sound is splayed, it's just so incredible. I invited my friend Bob over to come listen to him yesterday, and he was just gobsmacked. And he's like, this is unbelievable. Like, and we're both kind of talking to each other, trying to figure out, how do you find a speaker that is this inexpensive that can do what these things do? There's just nothing out there. I'm like, these companies are going to have their heads wrapped. They're going to be going nuts trying to figure out how to compete with these things. Small monitors, like if you look up top here, on top of that shelf way up there, there are a pair of Dynaco, right over there, Dynaco A10s. And when I listen to those things, I mean, they're just a joke, you know? They're so small sounding, you know? And you just can't get this kind of presentation in small speakers. There's just no way you can physically do it. Just physics won't allow it, you know? And I've never heard anything like it, nor has Bob. And he's using open baffle speakers, and he was like scratching his head. He's like, Jesus, $1,000 these things, $995. I mean, how do they do that is beyond me. And my understanding was that Wendell, the gentleman that runs Magnepan there, what he was trying to do was get these speakers out to people that couldn't afford the bigger models, right? And just as an experiment, so to speak. But I think what happened is the sales just got out of control with these things. And people are just loving them, even, you know, advanced audiophiles. Look at OCD Mike's his YouTube channel and website. I mean, he loves these things. And he was just flabbergasted with their performance. And I think it's important that value is part of the equation because, you know, there's a lot of people who just don't have the money to spend. And man, my recommendation is get a pair of these things. Now, you could consider, this is just my opinion, I prefer the REL T5Is. I've listened to the T7s and the T9s, and they're very good. But I absolutely prefer a down-firing sub over any other sub for musicality. The reason is because when the sub uses the floor, it works so much more efficiently. It's so effortless. For example, I had to turn up like the gain and the volume or whatever those controls were on the back of the REL T7Is and the T9s to get the same amount of bass. It just wasn't delivering, and it's weird because they're bigger, right? But there's something magical about downfiring, and it's so easy and effortless for the subwoofer to produce the bass notes. Now I know Magnepan is working on that new bass device that they have that people, I've not heard it yet, but I have thought about that. But one of the things that they said that was a little concerning to me is that people couldn't tell whether they were listening to that or the speakers themselves, these LRS. And I'm kind of hoping that that sound is not a different kind of sound, like a woofer, like a conventional speaker, because then it would be diminishing the point of what a panel is and what these things do, you know. But I don't know. I've not listened to it, so I can't judge fully, you know. But I think somebody mentioned something about those things going up to like 10 kilohertz, which is insane. And, you know, most subwoofers, I think they go like 80 or 120 hertz. I know the RELs, they do like 120 hertz is what they go up to. And what I would be more concerned with as far as integrating subs is not how low they go. Forget that. It's about how high they can go. How high can they blend so that they can, you know what I mean? It's a combination of those things, those elements, you know? And the subwoofer that I'm really interested in is that REL T0. It's $499. That to me sounds like a little game changer because it's not extraordinarily large or big. It's not going to have that boomy sound bass to it. And you know, it's going to be a 6.5-inch downfiring driver, and it's going to be fast and it's going to be musical. You know, I can tell when I listen to sound, you know, sound systems with subs, they don't integrate them properly. Even when I went to upscale audio, it was kind of like, yeah, I was listening to the Forte 4s and you could hear the difference with the subs on and off. And I just didn't like the subs. It just wasn't integrated right to me. My T5s, I had them integrated flawless, man. I could get those things working. Sadly, I ended up selling them. I don't regret selling them because I really felt like I wanted to go down smaller anyway. And I'll probably go with that T0 from REL. If you feel that you have these and you want to have some bottom end, that would be my recommendation to you. I have no doubt that thing's going to be good. I've not heard that the REL T0, but I'm sure it'll be nice. Like I say, the soundstage and the way these things present themselves is just unparalleled. I cannot replicate it with my Eclipse Heresy, nor can I do that with my Fortes that you see over here. They're just not going to produce that soundstage that you get. Now, they have more pounding, you know, like pounding bass in the Forte. They have that more of that impactful kind of sound, you know, than what the these things just disappear before you, and they're light, they're accurate, they're fast, and it's just so effortless. Interestingly, using the Shit Vidar 2, what I think it's doing is that if I were to put my volume control, say I put my volume control on my Aretha at 9 o'clock, so here I am, right? And I run this ST35 tube amp, okay, with my Fortes. If I hook the Vidar up to my Fortes, I have my position on my volume the same thing at 9 o'clock, right there with the Vidar. It's almost the same volume as this with the Forte. I think what happens is that this amplifier, I don't know, it goes from class A to class B, and I think it's running at this low wattage, 100 watts a channel, and then when you put them into these, you know, these Magnepans, they're just, They drop, you know, they're like, they're 4-ohm speakers, and I heard they drop lower, you know, when you play it. I think that's naturally the case, but the volumes are the same, you know. Even when I put 9 o'clock on the volume control on the Aretha with the Magnepans of the Vidar, they're about the same volume loudness as what my Fortes are, and I think it's because of what this amp, the way this amplifier works, you know. My friend is acquiring a pair of Jeff Roland M125 monoblocks and OCD mic on the OCD Hi-Fi channel. He goes rants and raves about those and about that product. And so I'm going to get those, and he's got those coming. And I'm gonna, you know, hook those up to this, and I'll do a review on the Roland, Jeff Roland amplifiers, the monoblocks. That should be interesting. I think they put out, 125 watts per channel at 8 ohms for mono. I don't know. I don't remember what it is. I'll have to look at the stats. But listen, man, I'm like, Ken, all I'm all about is sound. You know, you guys, I'll leave the designing to the engineers. Let them figure it out, you know. But yeah, I'm so blown away. Now, you will notice on the panel, there are three tie downs. You'll see one here, and one here. And on the base panel, there's one. So the tweeters are the thinner pieces here, these thinner ribbons right here, and the same thing on the outside here. Now, the reason that it's recommended to have the tweeters on the outside is to increase the size of the soundstage. Not that they necessarily need it. They have such a big soundstage anyway. But that is not an accident. If you go to OCD Mike's part one of the video of the visit at Magnepan, Mick, one of the service advisors there, he discusses about how these anchors, well, they're not anchors, he said, they don't call them that, they call them tie downs. But he was explaining how the right speaker here is your bass speaker, and the left channel is for your mids and highs. But he says you're not gonna hear it, and you don't. It's something I think that has to do with the physics of the actual design itself. It's not something you're gonna hear. So you're not gonna put your ear or hear more bass coming out of the right versus left. No, that's not gonna happen. What you're gonna hear when you listen to these things is this ultra rich, ultra open, velvet is like the best way I can. It's so smooth and sweet. Even with this Vitar, it sounds like velvety. It has this velvety sound to it that's just so mind-blowing. And like I said, my friend Bob came over, and he's got open baffle speakers and tons of tube amps and stuff, tube gear and stuff, and he's just gobsmacked at these things, and we're just going nuts. I was playing some Scott Hamilton on vinyl, and man, it's unbelievable. Now, what I'm using is my Denafrips RS2 for my DAC. And what I do is I run Cobuzz or Amazon HD Music through the hardwire, through my iPhone to the Denafrips. And then you get that beautiful sound that you get. And yeah, man, I can't say enough about this. I mean, you think of the value that you're getting with these, and it's so, no wonder these things are on back order and they're so hard to acquire, and the waiting periods are so long. And so this will be my pick, my number one budget system in the world. Ship Vitar 2, Magnepan LRS Plus, and if you want the Blue Sound Node, you want that streamer, the DAC, and the preamp stage all in one, then you got that. So, and another thing too, very important. If you want to spend the bucks, I'm telling you, man, this Vitar is an extraordinarily nice amplifier. All you need is to just put a good preamp on it. Then it'll just open it up nice. It's just, it's so holographic, man. These speakers are the tube sound of speakers. They have that spatial sound to them that you just cannot get from other speakers. It's bizarre. Anyway, I hope this helps you out. I hope you enjoyed this, and we'll be back at you soon. We'll be right back.
Now it's just another show.